Hey everyone, Anne-Marie from Hella Basque here, and today we are talking about Basque immigration. This is the first in a series of videos on Basque immigration all over the world, and today we are looking specifically at the United States because I am part of the Basque American diaspora in the US, and so I know a little bit about the subject. I did do some research, but I know a little bit about Basque immigration in the US, and a lot of you guys are really interested in that. So we're starting there. If you're new to this channel, real quick though, Hella Basque brings you videos every week about the Basque country and Basque people, so definitely subscribe if that sounds like something that interests you. But without further ado, let's get into it. Why are there Basque people in the United States? What brought them here? When did they come? How many are they? Well, there were Basques in South America. I won't say more about this because I'm going to talk about Basques in South America next video, but all you need to know for now is a few centuries ago there were quite a few Basques in South America, so that when the California Gold Rush happened in 1848 and everybody around the world found out that there was gold to be had in California, well, Basques in South America were very well positioned to just sail on up to San Francisco and try their hand at panning for gold. So a lot of Basques came from South America, Argentina specifically, to California to try to strike it rich, and a lot of them didn't make it. Nope, they didn't really find gold. They were late, or I don't know, not good at mining. I don't know what happened, but Basques, not super successful in the quest for gold. But since they were already here, a lot of them decided to stay. What they were doing in South America was ranching already, so they decided, well, okay, let's stay and do some ranching and sheep herding here. So a few Basques moved to Southern California and set up different ranching businesses there, but also they spread throughout the Western United States. Some of them set up boarding houses, which were like Basque only hotels, kind of, to welcome new Basque immigrants to the United States, and created like these Basque cultural hubs, really, where people could live there and speak their language and, you know, hang out with their own people and eat food that kind of reminded them of home. And it wasn't just new immigrants. The boarding houses were also really important to sheep herders in the off season, because in the winter they would come into town when they weren't working with grazing sheep. And I don't mean to just only talk about Basque men. Unfortunately, that's what these immigration stories focus on the most, is men who came over. There were quite a few Basque women who came too, looking for economic opportunities. So women were really crucial in running boarding houses, especially. Basque boarding houses were a really big deal because these Basques that set up business operations in the United States, they needed people to come help them run them, right? And so who better than to call upon your own countrymen from the old country? So Basques in the US would sponsor Basques back in the Basque country to come and work as sheep herders primarily, but also as ranch hands and just all around great manual laborers. For a long time, immigration to the United States, especially for Europeans, was pretty unrestricted. So throughout the 1800s, you had Basques coming in. It was only in the 1920s that there were laws passed in US Congress creating quotas for Spanish nationals coming to the US. They were really trying to cut down on the amount of immigrants coming to this country. So the 1920s, immigration kind of just really slowed down, practically stopped. That lasted until after World War II. After the end of the Second World War, they realized like, oh, look, we don't have enough people to be sheep herders. We don't have enough guys working these operations. So then a law was passed that basically excluded European sheep herders from these immigration quotas. So the floodgates were back open. Thousands of Basques came to the US to try their luck in America. Basque immigration to the US kind of really started slowing down in the 1970s with the decline of the sheep herding industry in the US, but also things started improving in the Basque country economically, because why were Basques coming to the US in the first place? Primarily two reasons. One was economic. There just weren't as many economic opportunities in the Basque country. There were a lot of big families on farms, and there just wasn't enough money to go around for people. So people would have to leave home to seek other economic opportunities. My dad was one of these people, and he always said too that at the time the US dollar was way stronger than francs where he was living. So it was like, if you're gonna work really hard and make nothing, why not try your hand at working really hard somewhere else and actually make some dollars? So one reason was economic, but also some people came for political reasons too. And sometimes, I mean, they came hand in hand. You can't say really if it was one or the other. In Egualde specifically, the southern Basque country, things were pretty bad for Basques under General Franco. So people were looking for freedom, you know? It's a classic American story. So people came over for different reasons. But in the 1970s, after Franco died, things started slowly improving in the Basque country. And that, paired with the decline of the sheep industry and tightening immigration laws in the US, there are not as many Basque people who come over nowadays. There are still some. I should also mention that it wasn't just Basques in the Western United States. Basques also settled on the East Coast, because a lot of them would come over from the Basque country on ships and land in Ellis Island in New York, and then they would get on Transcontinental Railroad across to the Western United States. But some just decided to stay. They liked what they saw in New York, and they hung out. So you have Basques on the East Coast, and also you have Basques in Florida. Miami, for a long time, hi-alai was like a huge sport. It was a big gambling sport. And who has some of the best hi-alai players in the world? The Basque Country. So a lot of athletes were also sponsored to come over to Florida to play professional hi-alai. But hi-alai is no longer as big as it once was, and like I said, immigration in the US is pretty tight now, so not so many people coming over anymore. A lot of people did just come and make money and then move home, but of the Basque people who stayed, they assimilated pretty well into American culture. For the most part, it was pretty rare for Basque people to come to an area and be a majority. Most of the time, Basques were ethnic minorities wherever they lived. So they kept to themselves in a lot of ways, but in order to do business, they really needed to learn English and work with Americans. But at the same time, they're still very proud of where they're from and their culture. So a lot of Basques set up Basque clubs where they live to put on parties and festivals, events. And eventually, these clubs formed the North American Basque Organizations, which is a big organization of Basque clubs, not only in the US, but there are a few in Canada too, that promote Basque culture. So they put on youth programs, sports programs, and some really good parties. So you could say I'm a very successful product of the North American Basque Organization's youth programs, because I was born in the US, but I guess you could say I feel hella Basque, because I mean, this is what I do every day, talk to you guys about the Basque Country. So yeah, Basques, they came to the US, some of them went home, some of them stayed, and some of them had babies, and then you have people like me. That's just a little introduction about Basques in the United States. If you feel like you learned something, give this video a like and subscribe to the Hella Basque YouTube channel. We're bringing you more videos every week on Thursdays, so check back with us then. And if you like my sweatshirt or this beautiful Basque flag throw pillow, I'm going to link in the description the Hella Basque shop as well, where you can go get your own. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you next week. Bye. But this is my cat, Winx. I usually lock him out, but I guess he wants to say hi today.